year since I last seen you.
We made a video exactly a year ago, basically.
Exactly a year ago.
That's crazy.
So I'm here with Manny from the Black Cyclist Network. Approximately a year ago today, we made a video together called the Black Cyclist Network. I'm going to put a link down below because it'll be handy if you watched it before watching today's video. In light of recent events, we thought it would be a good idea to revisit that, speak a little bit more about the Black Cyclist Network, why it exists, and
catch up, mate. Let's ride some bikes.
It's a tailwind if we go that way. Let's go that way. Looking for a little spot to stop and have a chat, but it's windy. It's really windy. I don't know if a microphone's gonna pick any of this up.
It's brutal out here. We've got Belgian, no, actually Dutch conditions out here. It's flat and windy.
It's still windy, so I don't know how well the audio is gonna come out. I guess you'll let me know in the comments.
I'm bored down on this. That is such a hack.
My tripod holder, it looks cool. So for new viewers, Manny runs BCN, Black Cyclist Network. He is the founder. You've been going a while now, over a year?
Yeah, over a year.
How's it all going?
It's going really well. As you know, so I created Black Cyclist Network, which is basically a welcoming place for all cyclists. But our main goal is we want to create a space for black cyclists and other minority groups. As you know very well, this sport is very white dominated. And it's not necessarily a bad thing, but when I'm sort of recounting my own experience, you know, I'm coming into the sport. I remember when I first joined cycling and I was looking for a cycling club. There weren't many people that looked like me, so I was very nervous. We all know that this, you know, cycling culture is sort of steeped in etiquette. You know, if, for example, group riding, as well as like, you know, what you wear, how you dress.
There's a lot to think about.
There's a lot to think about
already.
Yeah, you know, where to play, how to wear your shades, for example.
Mate,
so all that etiquette aside, like, you know, it can be a sort of daunting place when you're new to the sport. So the idea behind the Black Cyclist Network is we want to create that space. So when you come in, you can learn and develop and learn the same thing, but, you know, develop your confidence to the point where you feel confident enough to approach maybe your local club.
Yeah, so it's a stepping stone almost. It's not like you're going to ride just with the BCN and stay there forever.
I ride for Finsbury Park Cycling Club, and I'm also a member of Black Cyclist Network. So the aim is pretty much to provide, use BCN as a stepping stone to then, you know, to give riders the confidence to maybe enter racing if they want to, but also to do other things and become members of their local club.
Yeah, I'm sure you don't mind me saying it's definitely working.
Thank you.
We went out on a ride. The last time I did actually see you, how many people were out? Like 30, 40 guys?
Yeah,
all in their BCN kit?
Yeah, it's beautiful. Within like the past 12 months, we've seen so much progress. We've been, for riders that initially joined us that, you know, didn't really know how to ride in a group. You know, it was the first time riding with us, and they've progressed so much to the point where we've got riders that actually racing and winning races.
I'm interrupting this transmission with an advert for BCN.
If you want to ride with us, so we're a London-based club, so we meet up at 8 a.m. every Saturday at Regent's Park. And if you want to find us, you can find us on Instagram, Strava, Facebook, and on Twitter.
At BCN Tweet. Yeah, I know that one. I know that. So next thing I wanted to ask you, Manny, there's been a lot of conversations happening since the murder of George Floyd. I was keen to know from you what you think about the whole situation and what good can come out of it.
It's really unfortunate. You know, it's murder, you know, full stop. I think if you can draw any silver lining out of it, and one of the things that, you know, I think has come out of that conversation is the issue of racism and, importantly, structural racism, because, you know, quite often these incidents, when they happen, people sort of draw the line on an individualistic level. So, you know, people just say, oh, you know, it's just, you know, one racist incident, and that's it, and the conversation ends there. But we don't actually delve into the structural racism behind, you know, these sort of incidents. And when you actually look at it from that perspective, the murder of George Floyd, it's not on its own a single incident. There's a lot of like police violence that's occurred in America and also in the UK. We talk about, you know, police disproportionately sort of arresting, you know, black people. When it comes to drug use, for example, when it comes to, you know, cannabis use.
You got pulled over, right? Someone stopped
over.
You at a traffic light?
Yeah, like, you know,
your Lycra.
You see my video where, you know, I was stopped and searched by a police officer who who basically accused, alleged, and basically said that, you know, he smelled cannabis on me.
When we stopped you, we spoke with you, just as you were leaving, you noticed you might be able to smell cannabis.
Do you notice the smell of cannabis?
Yes.
Do you notice the smell of cannabis on my breath?
Manual.
Hang on, do you still notice the smell of cannabis on me right now?
A little bit at the moment.
And it couldn't have been any of these guys, just me.
We were speaking, you were the most close to
you. So you still smell that now, right?
At the moment, because it's been a little bit nervous.
All right, and you testified to that. What's your name, PC?
I was like in my full lycra, in my cycling gear. So just think about the absurdity of that, having to be pulled and stopped by the roadside and searched. Because
I don't think that's
because
ever
someone
I bet
suspects.
That's never happened to a white cyclist.
No, because of suspicion. I don't never happened to you.
It's so ridiculous we're laughing about it.
Like, it's ridiculous we're laughing about it, but it points to a wider issue, because when that happened, for example, right, I ended up speaking to our members in BCN. I spoke to them and asked them if they'd ever experienced, you know, similar situations, and we got a lot of young guys that were like, you know what, I get stopped and searched all the time.
Yeah.
And I know from my own sort of history, I've been stopped and searched on countless occasions. So the fact that the conversation is now turned into us talking about the structures, you know, that creates racism, it's really important, and because it helps us sort of look at it from that perspective. And from a cycling perspective, I think it's really encouraging to hear, you know, individuals talk about what they can do to try and, you know, help the narrative and to try and change the culture.
That kind of money leads me on to my next question, which hopefully will become a discussion in the comments of this video as well. If anyone has any questions, feel free to put them down there, and I'm sure you'll be happy to answer them. What can, one, individuals do, and two, cycling clubs and organisations do to help with this situation?
I think for starters, on an individual level, when you see, you know, racism or incidents of racism, call it out, you know. If your friends say, you know, something that you disagree with, let them know that, you know, what they're being intolerant and they're being racist. So that's the first step. In terms of what people, organisations and cycling brands can do, I think it's really important that you don't just pay lip service. You really need to make sure that you do employ, you know, black people and people of colour, you know, in your setup, in your organisations, to try and give you that perspective. What else you can do? My final point would be to have a look at the diversity in cycling report, which was put together wonderfully by my friend Andy Edwards. We've got some recommendations in there, for example, for cycling clubs on how you can recruit more black and minority cyclists. For example, one of the examples in there is creating more visibility. So if you are doing a campaign or you go to a website, just place in, you know, riders of color in your advertising campaign does so much to, you know, to encourage cyclists of color to come to your club. So it's little things like that, but have a look at the wider thing. We've got more recommendations in there.
I'll put a link down below to Andy's diversity report. Obviously some of you guys on the channel will already know who Andy is, but you put a lot of work into that, and it's got some real good points in there. So if you need some advice on what you can actually do to help the situation, it's all in that report, and as I said, well written. So check it out, description down below. Do it.
This isn't it.
It's gonna
just
rain.
Fluctuating, like.
You know what the worst bit about this
is?
We just had a tailwind.
Yeah.
So for me going home, headwind the whole way, mate.